Hello, everybody. Wednesday, beautiful Wednesday evening. Fall in New England.
Not too bad.
General public comment, going, going, gone. Welcoming our official new member now. Hurrah! So, Jack was officially...
That wasn't for you.
Jack was officially...
Move to reopen public comments.
Oh, yes. Public comments, is there something you'd like to, we just started our meeting.
I have nothing to say.
You have nothing to say? So Jack was officially appointed, was it last week, Jack, that the city council did that?
Yeah.
As a representative from the Conservation Commission. So, thank you for being here and now officially joining us. Approval of minutes, I believe we're just dealing with the September 16th, is that correct? Or is it the August one?
It was August and...
August and September.
Oh, July, sorry, we didn't meet in August.
July and September.
The previous meeting was July.
And I think that Dave did a wonderful job in some, actually significant additions to the September one.
Only with respect to something I said.
Well, thank you for doing that. Is there a move to approve the July meeting?
So moved.
Second?
Second by Devin.
Oh, sure.
Tried.
You tried. All in favor, all opposed? So with the revisions or additions from Dave, did people have a chance to see those? They came in a couple of days ago or something?
Yeah.
Move to approve the September 16th minutes?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Our first, Jack, let be known to the world that Jack has spoken. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, all opposed? All right. Moving right along to the fiscal year 16 financial transfers. And perhaps, Sarah, you can guide us through this.
Sure. So the CPA law requires that every community spend or set aside 10% of our total income in these three program areas. So rather than keep a detailed accounting throughout the year, our accountants have suggested that we just dump 10% at the beginning of every fiscal year into these accounts. So if we get an open space project, then we'll take it from that first and go to budget reserve afterwards. So these are a little bit over 10%, just to give us some leeway so we're keeping it.
Clearly that's yours to keep up with the balances being used and
yes.
Making sure that we hit that.
So this way, even if we don't spend 10%, if we don't get any affordable housing projects, for example, then that will just sit in that account. We won't have to worry about it.
How is the administrative account determined?
Administrative expenses can't be more than 5%. So we do 5% and then put all the extra back into the budget reserve to make it available for projects at the end of the year. We use about half of that.
And this is, of course, the estimated revenue, and then that's adjusted accordingly, is that?
We have a pretty good handle on what it's going to be at this point, so the guesstimating just over 10% should give us exactly what we need, if not a little bit more. It's okay to have more, but we just can't have less.
And when will the bonding for phase one of Pulaski be done, and so will that possibly affect the amount this year?
Of the revenue? The revenue will not change.
Well, the revenue won't change,
no.
But will it be an expense against that revenue?
So that is... So you're asking when will it go down?
Right. When will the bonding happen and therefore when...
The bonding for Pulaski won't happen this year.
But at all?
No. So that will most likely be next year.
However, the money that we have available for this fiscal year, we are
building, what the bonding amount will be? How do we do that?
So this order includes $65,000 for principal and $60,700 interest for Bean Farm, and $95,000 principal and $40,750 for Forest Grove. So that comes off the top.
But nothing for Pulaski?
No. That we won't have to start paying back until next year.
Is there an action that we take on this, sir?
So you would just need to vote to approve the council order.
I think we approved the FY16 financial transfer.
Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? So moved. Thank you, Sarah, for keeping such good track of our finances. Moving right along, the council order for our Lathrop Community Small Grant. Remember, we voted in favor of our first small grant proposal for $3,000 to the Lathrop community for some invasive work and all of that stuff. Sarah, is there, we have one condition, is that right?
We do, and I checked with Lathrop, and that was definitely not an issue for them, and they were happy to do it. So this will guarantee public access for the 3 years that this project is valid. And I sense that they probably would have been happy to do more, but 3 years.
I have a friend who lives on the trail, and I checked with her just because it's kind of obvious. She knows her neighbors, and she knows who's not a neighbor. She said it's used a lot by people that don't live in Lathrop, and I felt good about that.
And again, parking is not an issue. Lathrop allows parking, or do we park outside? How do we do that?
Well, there's a crosswalk that goes across the bridge road, and could easily park in the city area. There is parking, guest parking inside Lathrop. I don't think it's enough that they know this, it's not there.
You can also access it from the old Moose Lodge. There's a parking set aside, a few parking spaces there.
All right. Good to go on that?
My only comment that I submitted was I think it would be helpful, there's the resolution, but there's also the cover letter that goes with the resolution. And I'd like, since this is the first project, to send over, if we can, either a link to the small grant process or the narrative that we created so that the city council is aware of it and they can spread the word to their constituents that way.
Sure. Is there a consensus as to provide the actual text out, or just something? Councilors may be more likely to read it if we actually give it to them.
I think for the first time, we should give it to them, and beyond that, put the link in.
Any other discussion on that? All right, well, we're zipping right along here. We're a little bit early, but I do see Bob in the crowd. So, Sarah, do we need to wait till 6?
No, it's fine.
Or can we move right ahead?
No.
So folks just walking in now, or who have just come in, welcome to the CPC. We have five different projects that we are hearing from. And in order, not in order of priority, but in order of time, we're going with the Fitzgerald Lake, the BBC project first, Historic Northampton second, the Conscom Mineral Hills Habitat third, the Seth Warner Plot fourth, and back to the Conscom with the Rocky Hill Connector fifth. So we have asked that folks attempt to limit their talks to 5 to 10 minutes. We have had the opportunity both to read your proposal and also to read your response to the questions that we submitted. So hopefully we're up to speed on what your project is, but a 5 to 10 minute reacquaintance, I think, is appropriate. And then we have about 10 to 15 minutes for us to ask questions if we feel that that is appropriate or necessary. Is that correct? Did I phrase that correctly? So first up is the Fitzgerald Lake Bridge Boardwalk and Dock Rehabilitation. And I'm assuming that Bob, you're going to speak to that.
I will indeed. Are we doing PowerPoint tonight?
Well.
Under duress, yes.
Well.
This.
Chair Ward.
So this was the caution.
Okay.
But we're getting brand new stuff.
We apologize.
Sarah Ward made that. I just have to bring some problems. That's what I presented. In PowerPoint. No, put my flash drive away. Frederick Coalition's application to the CPC focuses on rehabilitation of the bridge, boardwalk and dock near the main entrance to the Fitzgerald Lake Conservation Area on North Burns Road. The bridge gives access to practically all of the trails in the Fitzgerald Lake Conservation Area. It's an essential part of people getting into the area to hike the trails or the lake and so forth. The boardwalk and bridge provide people the opportunity to walk through a freshwater marsh, to see the life of a freshwater marsh, to see the lake at close hand, and also to launch boats into Fitzgerald Lake. It's a very popular enterprise. I would say that the boardwalk is probably the most popular site in Fitzgerald Lake Conservation Area. People are going out there constantly, even if they don't get beyond that, across the bridge into the trails. An awful lot of people visit there every day. These structures were built about 20 years ago, and they've held up pretty well over the past 20 years. But in recent times, we've seen the slow deterioration of the bridge, the boardwalk, and the dock at the end of the boardwalk. The bridge, the supports for the bridge are slowly giving away. We have to go, you know, for the past several years, we have to go in maybe once a year to replace one of the original cement support columns. And the general situation is one that is not very safe for people. We're always afraid that there is some danger of the bridge giving way at some point. I think it's pretty steady and safe right now, but it is a worry. The boardwalk and the dock have been subjected to flooding for the last 3 years. They've been flooded, the outer portion of the boardwalk and the dock have been flooded the past three summers for many months at a time, and that has had a very serious, seriously bad effect on the state of the boardwalk. It has subsided in many places. The wood is deteriorating since it's been underwater. A lot of the wood has been underwater for long periods of time. And it really needs to be shored up and certain sections of it replaced. So to remedy the situation, we plan to replace the bridge with an entirely new bridge. We plan to repair sections of the boardwalk that can be repaired to replace others, and also extend the dock another 100 feet from where it is right now to get it into deeper water to make boat launching easier, and also to provide visitors with an opportunity to observe the lake clearly without having to look through cattails to achieve that. So the evidence for, oh, first of all, let me just explain, there's a map. Let me get my copy here. In the materials that I handed out, there's a map which shows the site of the work. And the position of the bridge and its approach ramps are fairly clear, fairly short segment. Then there's a black line that shows the path of the boardwalk ending in the dock. There are several sections that can be repaired, and we can talk about that in more detail if you'd like. But the outer portion, the outer roughly 100 to 120 feet, really have to be rebuilt. They will be raised a couple of feet, and at the site of the present dock, there is a new section of the boardwalk plan which will lead to the dock much farther away from the shore than at present, in deeper water. So the evidence for these various failings are shown on the photographs that accompany the stuff that I handed out. The first one you've seen before. It shows a picture of the bridge, the existing bridge. It shows a crumbling support post, and it shows the efforts of some volunteers to replace that post and shore up one portion of the boardwalk. One thing that you'll notice, if you're not familiar with the conservation area, is that the boardwalk takes a zigzag, and that makes it rather hard for people with disabilities to actually negotiate the bridge structure. The three other pictures on that page show the slumping of the boardwalk, the sagging of the boardwalk in photo number four, and it shows the outer sections of the boardwalk and the dock underwater during one of our floods, the one that occurred last summer. The next set of photographs are ones that I took just the other day, showing the condition of the dock after, of the boardwalk, the dock after 3 years of being underwater. This is the outer section. You can see, once again, slumping and sagging of the boardwalk. They're not too easily distinguished. The middle picture on the left, there's actually the mud is covering the boardwalk. It has sunken, subsided so low into the surroundings. And the bench on the dock has been badly damaged, it's lacking an arm, the supports for it are rusting. And the photograph in the lower right shows that water has invaded underneath the boardwalk in certain places and needs to be shored up. So given that, what we propose to do, and this, you can find the details on the three design sheets. Once again, they were part of the application, but just to remind you what we intend to do. The first one on the right side is devoted to the new bridge. The brook will be spanned by a 30-foot fiberglass single span, and wooden approach ramps will be built on each side. These will be new construction. The bridge and the support ramp will be supported by what are called diamond piers, and if you look over on the left side of the diagram, it shows the bridge structure, and on the left side, left bottom, shows a picture of a diamond pier. Diamond piers are used in wetlands. They don't do much damage. They sit on four legs, and actually, their footprint in the wetlands is quite small, much better than the piers and posts that we have now. On the right side of that diagram shows a picture of a helical pier, which will be used in another place. I'll get back to that later. The design of the bridge will take the zigzag out of the bridge structure. It will allow people with disabilities much greater freedom to cross that bridge and access further portions of the conservation area. The second sheet summarizes the construction, repair, and new construction of the boardwalk and dock. You can see the sections that are going to be repaired. Those are slumping sections that will be jacked up, and the support system will be improved, as I'll mention in just a few minutes. And then the outer section, where it says raising of existing boardwalk, that has subsided very seriously. That will actually be replaced and raised by a couple of feet. And then the very end of it, shown by the circle, will be the new extension of the boardwalk out to a new dock. The supports for the raised section of the boardwalk and the extension will make use of helical piers. Once again, very sparing of the wetlands, because it's just a single pier that's driven into the ground, and it's quite easy to construct raised structures using those as foundations. The parts of the boardwalk that are to be repaired, those are mostly slumping, sagging sections. They can be brought up to level by, jacking. And the support system for that is shown on the third sheet. At present, the boardwalk is laid on horizontal sleepers, which rest right on the ground. And if the ground subsides at all on one side or the other, then the sleepers will slump and the whole boardwalk will slump. So the idea there is to drive posts into the ground in those slumping sections and actually connect the sleepers after they've been raised to those posts, which will stabilize the structure normal level of the ground as it should be. So those are some of the construction details. It's been worked out by a company called Conservation Works, a conservation contractor in our area. And they estimated the project at a total cost of $80,000. We had a application into the recreational trails program of the Department of Conservation and Recreation. We learned a couple of weeks ago that we've received a $40,000 award from the RTP program with the possibility of a little bit more coming through with some additional justification. Now, what they expect the money, basic money, to be used for is reconstruction of the bridge, because they regarded that as a safety issue. They were had some questions about the boardwalk rehabilitation and would attempt to answer those. The project was actually approved, but is still awaiting some funding. However, the maximum that the RTP can contribute to any one project in a single community is $50,000. So because of those uncertainties, BBC has submitted a request for a grant of $40,000 to the CPA to complete the repair of the dock and the boardwalk, in particular, those very popular aspects of the structures within the conservation area. The one question that might come up is the new boardwalk going to be flooded again as the old one has been? I hope not. We believe that the lake level has been stabilized. There's been a persistent problem with beavers clogging up the dam drain at the far end of the lake. This leads to a rise in water level of the lake of up to a foot and a half. And the situation, I think, was finally saved this summer. You might have heard of the rock pile that was delivered to the dam drain. There is a chain link fence around the dam drain, which was supposed to keep the beavers out, but the beavers figured out how to get inside. So what we did this summer was to pile 10 tons of rock by hand all the way around the perimeter of the chain link fence, and it sort of forms a, you know, rock barrier around the bottom of the fence. So it's working so far. We believe that it will continue to hold. The final analysis, I think, will have to wait for a couple of months. The beavers are very clever. They're probably considering how to get around the rock pile right now, but we hope that that problem has been solved. And we felt confident about going ahead with the projects that we're proposing without interference from lake flooding in the future. So,
great. Thank
that's
you
about
for
it.
And happy to answer questions. Congratulations on the $40,000 grant. That's really quite exciting.
Thank you.
Questions from folks?
Did you name the beaver with? The dam drain, did you name that before or after the beavers? I was happy to read you got the grant, and I...
Right, thank you.
The only question I've got is just about the split in funding. When will you know about the grant?
They're actually, the RTP committee is actually meeting today on our request. The most that we could raise, that they could raise that, would be $10,000, up to a total of $50,000. So that would, you know, concomitantly, that would reduce our request to the CPC.
And you would be comfortable if we made that decision?
No, I wouldn't, because it's far from assured that the RTP committee will...
Oh, no, we would just say if you did receive that supplemental funding, then we would...
Of course, yeah.
So, thank you for bringing this one forward. This is, I think, those of us who go to Fitzgerald like encounter this, and it's one of those aspects of the trail system we all take for granted, where we step around, where we acknowledge, but it takes a lot of effort to put these in. And so, I think it's a great project. My own question has to do with the materials.
Mm-hmm.
It's not a judgment issue, it's just more for curiosity.
Sure.
Describes the bridge as being in part fiberglass, but has a wood decking. What
mm-hmm.
about the extension that goes the 100 feet further out into deep water? Is that going to be wooden, or is that...
That's going to be wood, yes. Uh-huh. Yeah, that will all be wood, except for the piers. They're made of steel.
Does it have the ability to float should the water rise, or is it going to be static?
We talked about that at length, that whether we should have a floating dock, and then some places, some conservation areas in Massachusetts have adopted floating docks. We felt that in the long run, it would be quite expensive to do that. We believe that we could settle the flooding problem, as I hope we have. And it's much more complicated to have a floating dock accessible to disabled people, as it turns out. And I should mention that everything has been designed according to ADA, American Disabilities Act, standards. And one of the things that I didn't mention may seem minor, but it is part of the standards, is that the curbs on the outside of the boardwalk and the dock will be raised to 4 inches.
What's the depth of the water at the end of the new pier?
At the end of the present dock is...
No, of the future.
Oh, of the future, 2 feet, yeah. We actually went out and made soundings sort of in a big semicircle off the present dock. You know, we went out to 100 feet or so and found a location where the water was seen to be consistently 2 feet. And we thought that was probably adequate for launching. The present dock, as you may know, is surrounded by cattails.
Mm.
And and there's a little stream that runs down. Part of it is actually running under the boardwalk right now and is carrying silt into the present location of the dock. And then there's all the debris from the cattails, you know, the portion that die out every year, which is just clogging up that channel out into the lake.
Just as a follow-up question, I applaud the work that you've done in trying to make, in the design, make it more mobility accessible. And that's wonderful, and also the intent to make through the new pier to make the lake accessible to boaters. It's important that people with mobility access also have access to boating. And as you know, while it's perhaps outside the scope of this year's application or this cycle's application, it would be wonderful to make Fitzgerald Lake be a showpiece for accessibility.
Mm-hmm.
And that would involve making actually a small floating platform with a kayak entrance and exit ramp with handrails.
Mm-hmm.
It's certainly outside the scope of this project, but I wonder if you're group would consider some extension along that line to make it more accessible in the future.
That's an interesting idea that we haven't really come to any firm decision about that. The people in the disabled community have actually found that the easiest entrance for people into canoes is a sloping shoreline rather than going off a dock. And this actually, I forget her name, I heard a talk last year at the Mass Trails Conference by a woman who heads up the relevant section of it's the Department of Interior. Gosh, I forget exactly the agency which she spoke for, but she's quite well known in the field. And she was explaining that it's really very difficult to build these accesses for disabled people from docks. And she showed us pictures of how just a level of a gradual sloping shoreline was the best place for disabled people to access boats. So we haven't really thought about a place where we could do something like that, mm-hmm. make that available, but I think it's definitely something worth
doing. That would be wonderful, yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you.
How long do you anticipate that this version would last at the...
Our estimate, which is really based to a large extent on what the folks from Conservation Works have told us, is 20 to 25 years. And there's several corrections to the original structure, which I think make that much more possible. The use of diamond piers and helical piers, for one thing, to stabilize either the bridge or the boardwalk or the dock area, will be much more permanent structures than concrete posts or wooden posts. Just on the surface of the surrounding ground. And the boardwalk itself, which is now built on these sleepers, which just rest on the ground, which was a very nice construction originally, but that has allowed the sleepers to, you know, sort of sink into the mud in an unbalanced way. So by driving wooden posts into the ground, adjacent to the sleepers, and then attaching the sleepers to the wooden posts should stabilize the boardwalk and keep it level for a long period of time.
The best preservatives also tend to be the most toxic in the lumber used. Mm. How do you balance that?
Well, the kinds of preservatives that are used now are approved for wetland use.
Okay.
Now, just what the details of the tests are that establish that, I can't tell you.
But that's approved by wetlands use by some independent authority, not just by the lumber manufacturer?
No, by some independent authority, yeah.
Not that I'm cynical, but I
It's quite routine, but I actually can't give you a detailed answer.
Okay.
The 100-foot extension into deeper water, correct me if I'm wrong, Bob, but the cattails just keep encroaching and encroaching. How do you come up with just 100 feet? Well, how long will that last? I mean, the cattails are moving in.
Mm-hmm.
Was there a rationale for not going further?
We thought, we have a rough notion of how fast the cattails are growing. I started working with Barbara Coalition maybe 10 or 12 years ago, and the dock was pretty much in the open at that point. The cattails had just reached the dock, and now they've extended maybe something like 20 feet in 10 years, 12 years. It's something we can't really, you know, we don't have a firm grasp on exactly how the lake is going to evolve. And it's true that there's some risk involved. We don't think that the area that we've chosen for the dock is one that's going to be silted in by tributaries into the lake. It is possible to get permission to remove cattails. It involves a bit of work to get the approvals to do that, and we have looked into that. So if it really becomes, you know, a tremendous problem, we would, or our future BBC fellows, I think we'll certainly look into removing the cattails to keep that dock in open water.
Can I ask an ecosystem question? I mean, I love the project. It seems to me that when you have a complex ecosystem not like that lake, and you start necessarily fiddling with it, beaver management, also all the development around it and so forth, you necessarily begin to interrupt its normal lifespan and normal stages of development and change. And we're all familiar with beaver pond becoming flooded and then unflooded and becoming silted and then becoming plains or
sure.
meadows.
Beaver
and
meadow.
So, but in a sense, we want this to be Fitzgerald Lake. We want this, it has become a managed property, a managed entity that has its own degree of wildness, but at the same time, it's a degree of human imprint on it, because we are trying to not have it be all silted in. We're trying to pull out Phragmites that don't quite belong there. We're trying to sort of manage it. And what's the argument back and forth about managing the cattails so that they don't become a sort of a natural version of Phragmites? It doesn't eventually become a field of cattails.
Yeah, I mean, that's a really good question, and it's one that we've talked about a lot. And there are techniques and there are companies who specialize in removing cattails, among other things, from lakes like this. They can be cut, they can be sort of dug up from the bottom and so forth with various pieces of specialized equipment. And that is done quite commonly. It's something that we considered for the dock area at one point, and we decided that, you know, not to go forward with it. That wasn't such a great idea. But the possibility is always there. I don't think that removing, a couple hundred square foot of cattails would have much effect on the ecology of the lake, because the cattails, as you've noted, are, you know, increasing little by little. So they tend to be invasive to that extent. I think in the very long term, I think there are going to be big changes to the lake. I think it will slowly eutrophy. That seems to be the impression of most people who know about those things. But that's, you know, from what little I know about it, you know, that's probably 50 years off. But it's probably going to be the evolution of Fitzgerald Lake, unless something fairly dramatic is done, it's dredged or... Which is certainly a possibility, but that gets into a very large scale project and would need quite a bit of public will to accomplish, I think.
We're conscious or mindful of the time and the folks are waiting to speak. Does anyone else have burning questions for Bob? You will let us know if this additional 10,000 is approved for
Absolutely.
Sarah?
Sure.
And that would theoretically be the end of this month, is that, or tonight, is that?
You know, I don't know. Amanda and Alyssa had a program, didn't actually tell me.
But soon.
When they might inform me, but it should be soon.
Great, yeah. Good. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, next up is Historic Northampton, with their proposal for both the Dane Shepherd and Parsons House repairs and the barn as well. We are absent, I believe, and send our best to the executive director and her mother, who she's unable to be here, so our appreciation that you've stepped up to do that for her. So if you could introduce yourself, please.
My name is Kiki Smith. I'm president of the Board of Historic Northampton. And I'm supported here by Chris Thompson, who will probably speak shortly, who is overseeing our work right now, the work you all funded. I do hear a theme about the effects of water on wood. And what that can do for long-term preservations, ecological systems. I guess I can briefly remind you of what your previous gift has allowed us to do. Just this morning, I went down into the basement of Parsons' house, and it's ready now to be foamed in as a vapor seal. The floor is absolutely clean. The horrendous furnace, which we arranged to get out, is gone. The lighting is great. The new entrance is great. And best of all, the back wall is not caving in. So that is fabulous news for us and really heartening. Another project which you all funded and which is Nancy notices in here, of course, was the stabilization of the basement of Shepherd House next door. And that is totally transformed and is dry as bone, more or less, however the dry bones are. So that is significantly improved. Damon House still has issues, and starting from the roof down to the basement. And we hope that we can attend some of those. That's where the majority of our collection is stored, in that building. Upstairs, the remarkable collection of textiles, and in the basement, furniture and other accessories down there. And since that time, we finally, this last spring, got a chance to get into the barn and empty it out. Took several big dumpsters to do it, and really investigate what was left there, and refer to that shortly. So I thought I would go through what the various things are that we have asked for. There's illustrations in here. Remember those games, those little movable tiles with little figures on them, and you'd have to jiggle and move them around in order to get the bodies realigned and into place? That is exactly what I feel like we're doing at this point, is jiggling spaces. Anyway, Damon House, the roof is a great concern. There are photographs in here of leaks and things, and some patching that's been done, but there are other areas. Along with that, the balustrade on the front is rotting away, and we'd like to get all of that done at once. Speaking of water, two significant concerns are the front steps, which, as you may have read, are tilted in towards the house, and the veranda on the side, which is tilted in towards the house, which is not only pushing water into the basements on those sides, but even affecting the whole structure of the building that way. So there's a lot of water damage we'd like to be able to change. We'd like to make it heal a few little bumps that make it difficult for wheelchair access into the space. It's becoming more and more obvious. The more lectures that we have and the more people who are coming in. We will need storage areas to rent to hold the collections if we can't fit them all into Parsons' house in this kind of jiggling for space. So it's mostly water damage around there. Shepherd House, the Shepherd Barn, as you may have read, is an exquisite exterior sculpture. And in fact, there's some sense that it's a lot older than we had thought, that had originally been considered. And it too has its problems with the sills all around the bottom and significant posts to hold the whole roof up. So we need, in order to do that kind of repair, we have to have an archaeological dig inside and on the perimeter to check to see what various interesting artifacts might be in there to tell us anything more. The same way we had archaeological dig this summer, outside of Parsons' house. There, we need a roof repair. We need to rehang the doors, to rebuild the ADA bathroom, and some of the interior stairs in there. Moving along to Parsons' house, there's some last projects in there. I don't know if you saw the photograph of the knob and tube wiring that's still in part of the house, which gives me the heebie-jeebies when I see it. I don't know whether that's an appropriate term in this kind of business, but it's still the heebie-jeebies. Again, there's some sills on the side L where our tenant lives, which are suffering from water damage, and some sashes around there as well. So then I think Shepherd House, for all intents and purposes, is done. So it's our concentration is on those three. I noticed that the first question that was asked was about how to prioritize these various projects. And as I suggested in this little wiggle room game, and as Nancy tried to spell out, it's so hard to envision not doing one in place of something else. They just are all so integrated, the repairs. And these particular repairs are pretty essential, particularly on the barn, if we want to keep it standing. We have some pretty great images, I think, of what we can do with these spaces. But until they're pulled together enough to have the public inside them, we're having some problems. So, and I want to emphasize that, and I think Chris would like to speak to that as well, that maybe reading Nancy's comments makes you think like the whole place is falling apart in a matter of moments. It's not. It's really so exciting what's happened. And that's what you all have provided, and it's given us the space to have a whole range of programs to increase our membership, to begin to plan for a capital campaign, to begin to focus on what we like to do and what we think we can do for the city. So do you want to speak briefly to the issue of the corrections there? Do you want to do that?
Yes, I think.
Mindful of time again, Chris.
Yeah, no, I don't have much to add. I'm mostly here. I'm a restoration carpenter, licensed general contractor, and I have been in charge of much of the work that was done this last CPC round. And it is quite remarkable what a relatively small amount of money, the effect that it can have. And this is just why this sort of local effort is just tremendous. And it is very exciting over at Historic Northampton, despite, walking around the next corner and finding the next rotten sill, which has kind of been my job, me and Nancy crawling around, finding all the worst spots we can possibly find. But we are learning more and more. We know that obviously the buildings have been pretty neglected for a couple of decades now, and we're all kind of getting our feet under us, and I've been a member forever and ever, but I've never done anything except walk through the gallery. Nancy obviously is recently on board. So we're learning as we go, and we're doing our best to keep things prioritized and as organized as possible. This is what I do for a living. So between Nancy and myself, I feel like this is, we work really well together, and we're at this point pretty well-oiled machine in all of our assessing and sleuthing and so forth. And there's a tremendous amount of energy. I've said before at other hearings, it's a great opportunity. The barn, I will speak specifically about the barn. I was poking around in there even before the blacksmith had left, and couldn't wait for that place to get cleared out. It's a very, very unique building. It has some framing details that I had never seen. I called up Bill Flint, the architectural curator at Historic Deerfield, and described it to him, and he'd never heard of it. It's it's a treasure that we still don't know a whole lot about. It would be obviously a dreadful shame for it to be lost. That being said, it's obviously a big ticket item, and it's pretty hard to just kind of pick away at it, particularly since we have to do this archaeology piece of it. So I'm happy to answer questions. I'm happy to have specifics about, you know, any parts of construction things. I do believe, my personal opinion, even though I'm a barn lover from way back, is that historic Northampton, if we were put in a, if they were put in a position of having to prioritize, it has to go to the main buildings and not to the barn, as much as it would be horrible.
I think you hear the last phrase you said, didn't you?
Even though the priorities really need to go to the main buildings, whatever funding needs to go to the, because then there is no historic Northampton, even though there's this really sexy barn out back.
Great, thank you. Questions?
One question I have is, it's always more expensive, you know, the contractor to do a job if the family's living in the house.
Oh, yeah.
And in this case, the family's living, the family is the collections, and you're moving things around and describing what you're doing. I used earlier this evening, if you're just laughing, and I used that same analogy of the sliding tiles. What would the sense be possibly of but putting the collection somewhere else for the duration, getting the work done, and then removing, then returning the collection?
For which part of the project? For the barn?
Well, for wherever. Well,
I'm
thinking more of the two houses.
Mm-hmm.
Right. We've been looking around for some large, heated, secure space that could absorb this. And so far, with all of our real estate connections, with other personal friends, and even Smith College, where I work, doesn't have any spaces. It's a premium. So Nancy's plan would be, as soon as Parsons is cleaned up and dry, that the large furniture, as much as we can, would get moved out of the front basement in Damon House, cleaned up and put into Parsons' house and stored there. That would leave us the front basement that could be cleaned and dried up. And then the next step would be to move all of the things that are in the back basement into the front basement so that that area could get cleaned up and dried out. And then we reverse the process.
Mm-hmm.
So it's possible, we figure, to do this.
Would it be cheaper to?
Well, you know, it's interesting, from my perspective, it's fine. I don't have a crew of 50, there are two of us. And so for me to take on the front, name, and basement, that's the project from start to finish. All of this moving around is all volunteers. I mean, Nancy's just incredible at getting these huge troops of volunteers to, you know, shove stuff across the yard over to Parsons. So
David, we actually asked them that question when they got the money the last round. And so that one piece of good dry basement that they did for that one seems like it's better than, you know, they're in a better situation than they were.
You're absolutely
the
right.
And
it's actually,
ready.
Well, the Parsons basement it's a lot of space. It's a big space down there. So yes, you're right. We're already, it's an easy game.
I appreciate what you've been able to do. You've put a huge amount of energy into it, and the place has come alive in a way that it hasn't been for a long time. But one thing that the questions keep trying to get at, and I know there's a lot there, and I know old houses you can't really predict. But this is the third relatively large request for CPA funds, and so having some sense of, is there going to be a fourth that you anticipate or not, or is this really going to take care of the, as far as you know, the major issues, and then perhaps your own funds and
barring any other hidden gems, Nancy says this finishes her hit list. Of the essential things that get done to stabilize these buildings and to be able to safely hold the collections. So undoubtedly, there'll be painting that needs to get done and, you know, there's always regular maintenance. But my sense is that these are the things that stabilize and secure the house and make them safe places to bring the public in, which is our major goal at this point.
And my only addition to that would be, I think that, yes, generally that's true. And at this point, you know, dozens and dozens and dozens of hours that Nancy and I have spent literally crawling around, I really think that, yes, we have a very good handle on what's going on. The only thing I will say out loud is that I was floored at the amount of knob and tube wiring I found in the Parsons house. I was would never have anticipated in a public building, it never even occurred to me that someone would ever let something like that slide. It's dangerous, it's not okay, it's gotta go. So I'm, that is like, I don't care if we don't get another dime, everything has to stop and the knob and tube has to be fixed. It's so irresponsible. It's just, I'm floored that it's in that condition. That being said, the only thing that now it never even occurred to me to ask, but I believe we need to do some sleuthing around and make sure that there's not an knob and tube in the buildings. Because silly me, I assumed that that stuff would have been dealt with, you know, 20 years ago. So that would be the only thing. And that's not $100,000, but it, you know, it could be 20 for a building like Damon.
I'd like to ask a follow-up question. So I would just say that I work for Hilltown CDC, and we have buildings that we own, and we certainly have lots of knob and tube we've had to remove recently in multiple buildings, so I'm not so surprised. But what we've discovered, and our these buildings are built around the 1800s, is you don't really know until you've done your demo. And so I just wonder, to what extent do you know about rot within the walls and places? Because I don't know what you've really done. So can you just sort of address that? What, you know, if you haven't opened it, you don't know what's there. So we discovered things like, oh, the plumber cut this beam out.
Oh, sure. One, oh, yeah. No, know. And I just, like I said, this is yeah. what I do for a living.
Yeah,
so when I walk around, mm-hmm. that's exactly what I'm looking mm-hmm. for, just those kinds of things.
Yes. Yeah.
Absolutely. Separation between floors and walls. What I look for are stress cracks in walls. There are these big, heavy diagonal cracks, mm-hmm. which really lets you know where the settling is happening. I can also tell a lot just from experience, how high is the ground up, how high is the building off the ground, how well is everything, you know, graded out around it. You can usually tell, generally speaking, if a building's been, how well it's been generally stewarded. That has a big effect over the long term of a building. Has it always had a roof on it? Has somebody let it go for 100 years before someone came along and fixed it, and those sorts of things. So because this is what I do, I'm pretty good at those assessments. But absolutely, no, it definitely happens. You go to open a wall or make a new hole or something, oh gosh, you know, there's a rotten sill. Well, hopefully you've got 3 feet of rotten sill and not the entire north side, because I've actually gone along with a screwdriver and poked the whole north side. Okay, it's not rotten.
Thanks.
So I have a question about the barn, because I love barns too. I think it would really be nice to save this barn. But, and I'm looking at the costs, and I was thinking maybe you could do some of the structural work, because you put it as your lowest priority. Maybe you could do the roof, you know, and the timber work.
You can't, though. No. You can't. Nope.
Well, maybe just cut out the bathroom. Right. I don't have a bathroom in my barn.
No, we don't have. The only thought about the bathroom was that the heavy work's been done, which is that somebody dug an underground line all the way out to this barn. So it has really good electrical and it has plumbing. It's got a drain, the city sewer goes to the street, water the whole nine yards. So that's been done, I don't know when. So there it is, all set up, ready to go. No, the barn does not have to have a bathroom. The only thought was that if we keep an ADA compliant bathroom there, the possibilities for the building become much, you know, you get one of those Renai space heaters, and now we can actually like rent it out for events, or you can have certain things like some easing, or you know, like
exposed storage kind of.
Right. So that was the thought. Yeah. But no, you could ditch the bathroom. Yeah.
For this year, maybe go back.
There is, you got a little bit logical, you know, labor's expensive, all these things take time to organize, and there's certainly for back, I'm always thinking about that stuff. It's like, what is the economy of motion? Where do we get the most out of this? Yes, there are three posts in the front of the building that are all three are really gone. They're barely have the sort of hanging from the roof. It's the roof that's holding it up. Could we just replace the three posts? We could just replace the three posts, but they're still going to be sitting on dirt because we can't dig a hole in the ground and fix the sills. So yes, we would get the posts back in and we could pile them up on some cinder blocks. No, I'm not being facetious, I'm serious.
Yeah.
We could pile them up on cinder blocks. Mm-hmm. Now the front of the building will be more stable. It won't be completely stabilized and it won't be on footings and et cetera. That's better. However, to access those posts, we have to peel off all this exterior finish, which on that building, unfortunately, from a cost perspective, is pretty, you know, it's clapboards, it's pretty fancy stuff. Okay, well, now we've taken off all the cladding. Well, gosh, while we've got the cladding off, we really got to fix the sills, and then, you know, and then you just, it really very quickly gets, it just doesn't. What I would be more likely to do if the community doesn't want to take this project on is suggest, and I don't even know if anyone would do, this just dawned on me right now, literally, is if there was any way to set up like temporary cribbing to support the roof on that whole front section until someone decided what to do with the barn. I don't know. That would be the only thing that I could think of on my own. I wouldn't do it with my liability insurance. Maybe somebody would. I don't know.
Any other questions?
Thank you.
Does Mr. Northampton agree with Chris's assessment? If money was short, that the money should go to the other buildings and not the barn?
It hasn't come up specifically in the board meeting.
Nancy and I have talked about it quite a bit.
But, you know, I wouldn't be surprised, but that's the consensus there of the priorities. Because without the other buildings currently holding the collections, and where we have the most immediate opportunities to develop programs, we need those main buildings safe and able to be better used.
Okay. And the archaeological dig at the barn site, is that necessitated because of the plumbing issues? Or
No, it's whenever you do basically anything. You can't dig, I can't go down more than 4 or 5 inches and you gotta get the archaeology done. So. It's really irritating.
We're historical.
That's right. You have to do it. You have to do it. But boy, it certainly slows down my ship. That's for sure.
So it's for the footers, for the beams.
I'm sorry, Sam.
You need to dig for the footers.
We do, exactly. We would put piers underneath each post. So there's 12 of them.
So instead of the various ways you could fix those posts, can you do anything to fix the rotting tie-ins from the roof to the post that are just temporary, that it's not a partial fix, but you sister them or you do something with them that just says, we'll get to you next? Is there any, would it have to have
Well,
a roof?
Right now, this is one of the reasons why I'm sort of a barn junkie. Barns are just remarkable. Timber frames are remarkable. So here's this barn that has 4 posts on the back and 4 posts on the front on each side. So they're taking all the load from that big heavy slate roof and all the snow and on and so forth and so on. 3 of them are completely out of commission. And you go up in the eaves, and for right now anyway, all of those big, heavy, very complicated English tie-in joints, for right now, they're all still tight. And it's quite remarkable. The rafters aren't pulling from the ridge, like everything. We were really quite impressed. So one, that's why we say it could actually wait a few more years.
But would it need a roof to do that?
No, I would not go. I would repair the holes, but no, this no slate lasts forever.
Okay.
So no, the slate's fine. It just needs repair.
Okay. Last comment. I love barns so much. I'm moved one.
All right.
How many barns do we have in downtown Northampton?
With a slate roof, that's really unusual, isn't it?
Well, it's Victorian. It shouldn't have a slate roof.
So originally,
and they added rafters to support the slate roof because they knew it wouldn't hold.
Could you briefly explain the kind of the strategy that Historic Northampton has about increasing your public support by membership or fundraising or events, and how that might play into, you know, future maintenance? Because obviously this is a result of a lot of deferred maintenance that now is, has to get fixed. But going forward, once this gets done, it becomes beautiful again in the eyes of the city.
We did get a significant grant to help Nancy launch his Northampton timeline, which is a long-range project of layering maps on the computer, inviting every resident in this town to submit a photograph of themselves and their family in their house. That would be located right on the top layer of the map. And then subsequent earlier versions of those houses, we would find the deeds, we would find any photographs and images, to begin to get the whole community aware of how they themselves are part of the historic community. We feel that's, so everybody owns this town that way. So we're not just about holding a bunch of articles, it's how to incorporate history to the larger group. So that's one project. Part of that will be doing another one of those 48-hour photography timeline, so that we archive images of the town. We can't hold vast amounts more archives, but we can hold the images of moments of time of this particular community. We have this remarkable series of lectures that Laura Sanders is doing about, which introduces us to the whole idea of the intersection between the history of the ecology and the geography of this, how that affected the development of this city. And that, to me, opens up a whole other idea of the history of this town. So I think what I could say is our intention is not to develop one little exhibit after another. It's to incorporate the schools more and serve their work, and incorporate projects that bring in the larger community that we could fund outside of an organization like this. I'm not sure if that's getting
well. I was looking more for the financial aspects of it, which would help to
sustain
what you're trying to preserve.
Well, we've already tripled our membership since, I think, Nancy, we got the last grant. And we anticipate being up to 500 by the end of this year. Doesn't mean we keep everybody, but we've done that. We are trying to make a conservative estimate. If we can maintain those 500 and add another 200 and maintain a kind of average amount of a donation, that begins to maybe give us the breathing space to pay for a full-time executive director. We've got that issue, because Nancy isn't going to survive doing this work the way she's doing it. We've got other grants. Once we get our finances better in order, or for a consistent period of time, now that we're just about in the black, which is phenomenal given what our status was 2 years ago, now we'll be able to apply to other granting institutions to help support some of the ongoing projects that we'd like to do, which up till now, why would they want to invest in something that looked like it was going down the tubes? So once we get our house literally in order, once we get our books balanced, and once we feel like we've got enough evidence that of the community supporting us with that, plus larger donations, which we really haven't gone out to do yet. So we're trying to get our house in order to figure out, if we can get our house in order, where do we go to get subsequent larger funds. But these are our steps we're taking now. But we feel really confident, in a way we didn't a year ago, let me tell you.
I just press a little bit more on that, because one of our obligations under the CPA is to ensure that our investment is well served and that there's some longevity to it.
Yes.
So have you estimated what your maintenance costs for these buildings would be for each year and the coming year?
Well, for one thing, they've gone down maintenance costs because of the changes in the furnaces that we've had, which is, so the amount of investment in the oil just to heat these places. But in terms of maintenance,
Another thing was, somebody brought up the storm windows in the list of questions. I didn't remember what they, anyway, storm windows not only bring down your heating bills, they also literally protect your investment. Because windows are really expensive, and the Damon House now, half of them have been restored, and the other half were also, you know, refurbished and reglazed and painted and stuff. So this money has been, CPC money has been put in to the windows. Now they get protected behind low E dead light glass. Now they'll last, you know, they'll last 30 years instead of 8.
Yeah.
So there's that. And all three buildings will get exterior storm windows because of the last funding round. So that also, from a maintenance perspective, helps quite a bit. But yeah, I mean, the buildings will need, well, Shepherd has a slate roof, so that's just sort of ongoing repairs.
If you get a new roof on Damon, that ought to last, what, 30, 40 years at least?
30. And I know Parsons had a, I remember when that was done. I don't know if CPC paid for that or not, but Parsons got an asphalt roof 10 years ago or so. It looks okay. It definitely wasn't the highest grade asphalt shingles, but you know, it certainly got 10 years on it. Parsons will need some, well, if we do get some funding, I've got in repairing, Parsons needs some siding repairs. Not a lot, but some. But at that point, it will be cleaning gutters and making sure things are sort of up and running. It will be a much more level playing field, which I would assume, you know, at historical Northampton should be able to absorb most of that.
Yeah.
Right. And I guess my question is going more from the assumption to the reality that there's a set aside or that you've allocated money to a maintenance fund as opposed to a reserve fund for something
right.
catastrophic.
Right.
So have you done that planning?
Not yet. We're trying so hard not to spend what little investment.
Right. I recognize it's a
concern. But that is a critical part of what we would want to develop in part of doing the capital campaigns, is to have that set aside. I mean, I was just listening to the funding that this committee sets aside for unforeseen circumstances. So we'd be remiss if we didn't do that.
Yeah, I would just add, these are actually foreseen circumstances. It's a way of managing your renewal.
Yeah.
So that putting money aside from reserve fund
right.
is absolutely, once you get out of the hole, and I completely, you're so recently out that you're still dusting yourself off, and no one expects you to have this right now, but I would, going forward, as you get successful and as you begin to look at hiring executive directors and beginning to think about bells and whistles, have the discipline to say, no, we also need to be setting aside X amount of money.
I don't think an executive director would want to come in unless they knew we were aiming for that.
So that there is a recurring reserve fund,
Additional questions? Kiki, Chris, thank you so much.
Thank you
are
very much.
To Nancy and her mother.
Thank you.
So Wayne, thank you for your patience. You are next up, I believe, for the next three, is that correct?
Yeah.
So we have you starting with Mineral Hills Habitat, moving on to Seth Warner and the Rocky Hill.
Okay.
Seth Warner.
So Mineral Hills, this is part of your new grant program, Rex and Four. This is Mineral Hills, one of our three largest conservation areas. It extends north all the way up to Chesterfield Road, Montague Road. And that area was in farming until, I'm not exactly sure, but maybe 15 years ago, 20 years ago. It was sort of grazed pasture. And the pasture is stopping use, and when we took it over, it started being attacked by both non-invasive plants and invasive plants. And what we want to do is clear out that stuff now, while it's pretty easy to do, where you can just come in basically and mow it down. And not, you know, if you ever get invasive when it's mixed into a forest, it's fairly easy to do it when it's just a set site. Our long-term use of the site is still unclear. In an ideal world, we find a farmer who wants to farm the property, and then it'll be self-maintaining. no farmer wants it now because it's so much clearance to get there. We may never get a farmer. This is, you know, fairly far north in town and north facing, so it's not ideal country. DPW is looking at to see would it work for them for a tree nursery. We've talked to a couple of farmers who weren't interested in it, at least, you know, might conceptually be. So that's sort of one scenario, and then we wouldn't be doing any maintenance that the farm would be doing for us. The alternative that doesn't work is then we're just sort of in routine maintenance. We do this at Cook's Pasture, we do it at Fitzgerald Lake Dam, we do it a couple of spots. We'd be cutting a site every couple of years. So it's much easier once we get everything cut down. So, unless this question is pretty easy to get.
Have you thought of goats?
We did think about goats, actually. One is we looked at Goat Girls, which is the Amherst group. We asked them.
Surprisingly expensive.
They're really expensive. We also approached Grow Food Northampton to see, was there anybody who might be interested in starting a goat farm? Because the reality is, the same money we could pay Goat Girls, we thought, wouldn't this be great? Maybe we could start getting someone. And I know nothing about animals, but they said it's not as easy as you think it is, okay. And no, they're not aware of anybody. But we would love to find goats.
Have you thought of it?
We looked at, you know, Sarah found a grant a couple of years ago that was for planting fruit trees, and we looked at that, and again, north facing, not ideal fruit tree site. So we're really sort of at the point of, do we give up ever for it for being farmland and just let it grow up, or can we restore that?
As I understand, William, the advantage of doing this now is that it hasn't gotten away from you, and that if we wait several years, it'll be so overgrown that it'll be really hard to manage it.
That's right. Exactly.
Okay.
So as I think most of you know, you all funded a study where we hired Lori Sanders to look at all our conservation areas. I just heard you talking to Historic Northampton. Part of the reason she's doing the series for them is she developed a lot of information on your dime and our dime that gives her great stories to tell. And so we asked her to look at all our conservation areas in terms of what were the needs from the basis. She wasn't really comfortable saying, here's the top four things, you should do these four things first. She was very comfortable telling us the problem in all the conservation areas and which ones are really important. So this one and Brookwood Marsh and Elwell were the top three that we identified coming after work for doing something. And we're now working on all of them.
Who's the we in that statement? Is that planning? Is that CONCON?
So everything has to be approved by CONCON. So the way it works is things that are covered by our open space plan, staff can just go ahead and update the Conservation Commission. Things that are new that aren't in the open space plan, we have to go back to the Conservation Commission. So the biggest thing we've done last year, Sarah found us a grant for forest stewardship, and we did work. We in the planning office hired someone two different consultants to do work clearing at Elwell, at Connecticut River Greenway, the Elwell section. So that was sort of our top priority. Lori's done some work looking at purple loosestrife at Brookwood Marsh. We had maybe 12 years ago released beetles that in an effort to attack the purple loosestrife, and it was not particularly successful. Sort of right at the borderline of the work. That site may be simpler in terms of physically pulling that. But all those things we discussed with CONCON as we go forward.
Okay, now we'll return to that in a minute. So I think that was part of it. You know, this came in on the small grants and we punted to the traditional rounds. I think there were questions about, I had some, I know others did, how this interrelates with that assessment as well as the Conservation Commission's and planning's priorities. But before we get there, I'm not sure if I'm getting a mixed message or I'm not understanding the purpose of this. But on one hand, there's a heavy emphasis on bobolink and savannah sparrow and other species and managing for those particular habitats. I also hear, you know, we have an organization or an entity within our own local government that may want to use it for native tree farm. They don't sound like they're entirely consistent. Maintaining something in a grassland state versus maintaining something in a shrubland state versus maintaining something as an orchard or something else seem different. And if I can't tell if the purpose is truly habitat for species that are on the decline, or it's just management for having this managed so it doesn't go into forest. Can you speak to that?
Yeah, so there's two answers. One is, because we don't know if it's a final farmer, it's hard to tell you what's our end game 10 years out from here. But no matter what we do, we want to be rich for habitat. So, for example, we cut the Fitzgerald Lake Dam every year. But we always cut that, or we range for it to be cut. We always cut it after August 15th because we want to make sure that it works for ground nesting birds. We work with Smith Vocational School. We need to do more work on that, but for the Drumlin, the State Hospital. And that was, they have a new management plan, which frankly, we haven't been involved with, but the last management plan was all the clearing had to be after August 15th, because that was a recommendation for grasshopper sparrow. So I think if we did, if we were able to do farmland, we would still want to think about what are the ways to manage the property to maximize grassland birds. But we haven't done a management plan because we don't know what those uses would be. So if it's not farmland, it's just about grassland habitat. If it is farmland, we want to figure out how can we get some of both those things there. So in concept, we think we're consistent, but until we get an end user, we get, you know, DPW, for example, we've pitched three sites to them. They're looking at the sites. They may choose none of them. They may choose one. If they choose one, we would have to sit down with them and say, here's the sort of management where we think these two things are consistent.
And in terms of our open space planning and the priorities of Conservation Commission, which is more important in terms of creating grassland habitat for birds or creating farming opportunities?
I think they're both important. I'm not sure we've set up a priority. I will say, you know, we nowadays, because of CPA, in the old day when we bought land, we had more management discretion going forward. When we buy conservation land now, as a condition of the CPA Act, we have to put a conservation restriction on property. So we have to spell out some of those things. So that was the Special Conservation Commission 4 years ago. When we bought this property, we bought 80 acres at a time, I'm making up the number, I don't remember the right number. We granted a conservation restriction to Kestrel Land Trust. The conservation restriction allows us to convert up to 5 acres, but not more than 5 acres to farm. So that was the discussion of the Conservation Commission approved, where we could use it for farming, but not more than 5 acres. So in terms of priorities, we think that's the right mix. 5 acres out of all the Solomon Hill. And at the old Palm piece on Mineral Hill, on Sylvester, we have another piece of farmland. But we think that's the right mix out of all the land we own up there, is two small farm parcels.
Other questions? No?
Okay. Yeah, no. Can we go then back to how this fits into the larger picture? When you came in for the original ecological assessment, there were two pots of money. One was to do the assessment, get the priorities, with the emphasis on the holistic approach to steward all of our lands and target what we thought priorities for invasive species and other threats might be. That's now done, but we have this coming in under small grants. You also had a separate pot of money for priority projects, and we punted on that, saying we don't know what the priority projects are, so we feel awkward giving the money. So my question is, will you and the Conservation Commission look at that ecological assessment and be returning to us and saying we need this large pot of money and here are our priorities, and you'll have the discretion to address them at a new basis and have that pot of money like the Conservation Fund would be, or are we going to see every round two or three of these invasive species proposals, which in my mind, this is just my perception, would kind of overwhelm the small grant program and isn't intended for that kind of segmented thing. It seems if it's intended to be holistic, my preference would be the larger grant. But I wanted to ask you that question. Is this kind of just
we haven't had a discussion yet. I think we'd take your lead. You know, if you collectively would rather we come back with one large grant, we'd be happy to do that. If you'd rather we come back with small grants, we'd be happy to do that. We really, we had an agency conversation with CONSCOM that way. We did, just to be clear, because we have some money left in that first grant, you said it's done. So we hired Lori to look at all the conservation areas, which is done, that helps us prioritize. There's still some money left in that pot. And so we're now hiring her on a case-by-case basis. So she led some work, not in conservation land, but in Northampton, to deal with certain bases along the Oxbow. We paid for her time and volunteers helped her when we did the Elwell project. We paid for her. We had a study done. She basically had sat down with a forester and sat down with a logger and said, here's the places to cut. The same thing for Mineral Hills. We plan to use the money that we have from that first pot of money for the basically putting the bid specs together
that we're not asking for money for CPA as a pass, we're asking money for the cutting. But going forward, as I said, we take your lead. We haven't talked about it or thought about it.
Okay, so, clarify, you answered the question. This is one of three priorities for invasive species management that have been previously identified. So this is just follow through on that.
From Lori's report, so right. Previously, that's right. She may have heard this already, so forgive me if you already heard this. But Lori's report had some really bad news and some really good news. We sort of guessed, but not the extreme. The edges of our property, wherever habitat changes, wherever there was logging, wherever there were roads, wherever there's rivers, was far worse invasive than we thought. The good news was the center of our properties is far better, far less invasive than we thought, which is some very clear management potential. Like, you know, when I was undergraduate, which is a long time ago, you know, people in my field really talk to think about edge. Lots of edge where deer like hanging out. Now it's the opposite. Now we want to minimize our edge as much as possible, have big clusters of grasslands and big clusters of woods. So we know that piece from hers. We know our top priorities. But in answer to your bigger question, we haven't done a strategy beyond sort of the lowest hanging fruit.
And then one final one, which I think I asked in the question, I may not have asked it as pointedly as I should have to get the answer that I was hoping to get, but in Lori's report on these parcels, she had four recommendations, and this restoration, enhancement, maintenance of this parcel is one of those, or there are two of them, but it also had the creation of a small parking area and then the reestablishment and maintenance of existing trails. Is that something that
The third one, the trails, absolutely. The seller of the property just before he acquired it did a fairly aggressive timber cut, and I think we'd like to let a little bit of stuff rot and disappear. So there's two reasons to put that off, but at least it's a plan reason. One is we want more of the slash to rot away and not be there. The second is our long-term goals. We now, I got the exact distance, but the land we have in the north part of Mineral Hills is an in-hold, a private piece of property. It's only about 400 feet long, and then the land in the south part. And the dramatic trails come when we acquire that 400 feet, and we can connect all the way through. So yes, we do trails. It's an isolated spot. Someday, if it connected, we do trails immediately. The parking lot, again, no special CONSCOM. We are a lot more reluctant. We've tried not to have parking on conservation properties. So the only time we've done parking is when we think it's really dangerous to park in the street. So on Sylvester Road, we have a parking lot because it's a horrible place to park. In our two conservation areas, one we built, one we inherited. This area, I don't think Montague Road is unsafe to park as long as we're only getting two or three cars. So I think we'd watch it. If we suddenly owned all the way to Turkey Hill Road, we filled that gap, and we started getting more people walking, then we'd certainly do a parking lot. But I wouldn't recommend a parking lot until we had the need to get there. But at least we're certainly looking at her recommendation trail, which she never expected us to take them, you know, wholesale. And so we're certainly looking at one trail, which makes sense.
Right. I think the reason I'm asking is we were only provided with the report and recommendations. We don't know to what degree they've been deliberated over, decisions are made, or whether it represents the thinking of planning or conservation.
Well, last thing, I'm sorry to go on, but just so you know sort of our conversation with the Conservation Commission, how that works, it tends to be relatively small management decisions. And even though we'd be very appreciative if you give us this money, admittedly, it's a fairly small project. We do sort of on a routine basis, we bring up the Conservation Commission, we need their approval. Bigger capital items, and parking lots fit in capital items, we do an open space plan every 7 years. And that tends to be, we would put off that discussion. So our current open space plan runs out in 2018. And so we would have that wholesale discussion. Where should there be parking lots elsewhere? And so that, unless there was a crisis, we just would wait until the next open space plan.
Jack, anything from the crowd's comment?
No.
No? Okay.
Covers it well.
Linda?
Thank you. Thank you.
All right, well, good to go. Any other questions? Thank you, Wayne. On to the clock.
This is very exciting. See, you all, just as a quick reminder for newer members, you all funded our purchase and set warrant clock. Maybe it was 2 years ago the funding came through. It took a while in terms of logistics, and the guy who's selling it to us lives in California. We just closed about a month ago, so
we're closing out that CPA grant. We wrote them a big check. The city took title to the clock. The beautiful, decorative, very expensive parts of the clock are in my office for security reasons. The huge, heavy metal piece is out of the city's leachate plant because it's temperature controlled and safe out there. So we own the clock. We asked last time for money to fix the clock. My read, you can obviously correct me, was you all were interested, there wasn't enough money. You gave us $500, $1,000, some short-term money, and we used that money for something, so the clock got delivered, we had to pay for the delivery costs to take it out there. We had an opportunity to buy one particular decorative piece. There was a clock festival in Ohio, and this piece was made in Texas, and so we bought this one critical piece that we know we're missing. So we've been moving forward. Our next piece is to rehab the whole clock. Pulaski Park is under construction now as part of the phase one, which is partially funding, obviously lots of other funding sources as well. There's going to be a, concrete piece, so the whole of the clock, that's gonna be built as part of this first phase of the clock, so you know exactly where it's gonna be. It's under construction, it's gonna have a conduit there so we can light the clock. So that's part of this phase one. Construction begins next week or the week after. We would like to get money. Obviously, we'd like, everyone comes here, I'd like to get money, but we'd like to get money to rehab the clock so that when they're done with this phase and they have this concrete piece, we can finish the clock and bring it in. It's a fairly long lead time because this parts, the clock was taken apart in pieces. Some pieces are missing, have to be fabricated. And so it's a long lead time because we hire someone who plans it all, puts it in the clock, sandblasts the metal, orders the replacement pieces. And so this would basically let us rebuild the clock. And we keep finding more old pictures. We had, I think we were here before, we had pictures of Calvin Coolidge with the original ribbon cutting when it was put up down there. We found some more old pictures that came with the clock. The guy who owned the clock gave us his old collection.
And at one point there was there was an ad on a superficial sort of arch that went over the top. That's not going to be included.
Yeah, we have that.
That wasn't original, I know.
It wasn't original, and it's sheet metal, so it's not cast iron. That's the piece that I said was bought in Texas and came up through us. So it's a decorative piece. It's a recast of things on other sex Warner's clocks. So we plan to put that on it instead of the advertising piece.
And
that's
what
office
I should be. I should be sure of this, but I've forgotten. You plan on having it be returned to being a mechanical clock.
That's correct.
And somebody from DPW would wind it?
So we have to figure that out. My understanding is it only requires winding once a week.
Okay.
There's a woman, Gabby Immerman, who works at Smith College, and her son, who's 12, is the winder of the Haydenville clock. And he happens to
be charged. Is that a position in town?
Is that
a position in town?
Apparently.
It should be. That's good, yeah.
And he happens to go to charter school down here and comes to Northampton every day. So if he's interested in the position, we haven't made any commitments. But I think finding a winder is pretty easy. It's a volunteer thing. It's once a week. You know, the bigger thing, obviously, is that, and again, this is not my field, it has to be oiled or greased or whatever it does to clocks once a year. That's the more complicated. But the winding, we don't think will be difficult.
There would be money in the city budget for routine maintenance.
For routine maintenance, right. The winding, we think, is going to be free. It's a volunteer piece. Yeah.
I think this should be an official position, an appointed position.
And the clock will also
be identified on the city website.
The clock will also be lit, which obviously wasn't original, and now we just had a DPW's electric budget.
And the exact location?
Well, everything's changing. So if you come out the farthest corner of Memorial Hall and go out into Pulaski Park and then go close to Main Street.
Right there.
Right there.
You can see it from Main Street.
You can see it from Main Street, right.
Until you mentioned Calvin Coolidge in a picture with the clock, I hadn't thought of this, but would there be any kiosk or planning or informative? I mean, people will know it's a cool looking clock, but we have a way to tell them the history of the clock?
Good question. We haven't thought about that at all. You know, we've had, in some of our conservation area, we've done these small brass plaques that are very small and open a lot of information, but they're also very subtle. So it makes sense, but that's the first, we haven't thought about it, frankly.
What is the long lead time we're referring to?
Well, I don't really know. I mean, 6 months to a year, I know it's a big spread.
No, that's
sorry, Linda, what's
that's
the
good
question?
What was the question?
The lead time. He had mentioned there was a long lead time, and I was waiting all about.
There's certainly more than one clockmaker, but so far we've only had three names in New England, so it's not a huge universe of people who are going to respond. So it's probably, we have to do a bid. So it's probably going to be partially based on how busy those three people are.
So you'd say the clock repair takes time?
Yes. Right. Because again, one per...
I understand.
Wayne, there'll be a $5,000 match through fundraising. Have you thought about that?
We haven't thought about it, but that's sort of a magic number that's not that hard to get to. So we feel like we're comfortable with it. So when we did the art on the bridge, the Main Street Bridge, that was a $30,000 project. The first $5,000 we basically said anybody interested in that came in the door. So we anticipated a similar thing. So we were trying to do fundraising that didn't require an enormous effort, and that seemed like a realistic amount. We're doing a gateway sign at Lampton Park, and same thing, it was a $10,000 project for the first $5,000. Seems to be a magic number that's pretty easy to get donations for.
Other questions? Yes. Last, the Rocky Hill Connector.
So, again, for those who've been on the board for a while, we tend to do several land acquisitions a year. Typically do one big land acquisition, and we do a separate application for you, and a lot of small applications, and so far at least you've given us a conservation fund that helps doing that. These are always matches, so we're using your money, which we're very thankful, and match it and go as far as we can. So this is this year's big application, Rocky Hill Connector. Last year we bought a place that we're now calling Rockaway Greenway, Rocky Hill Greenway, sorry, which goes from Route 10 to Route 66, along power lines. If you're bikers, just before you cross the Route 10 bridge, it's the property on the right. This is the next property just south of there. I guess it makes me admit how long I've been here. When I first started working with the city, one of the first projects I was asked to work on was creating a business park. And so we zoned about 120 acres as a business park land. We knew even at the time that it was incredibly valuable ecological resources there. And so the original business park concept was we wanted 120 acres business park, but 50% of land had to be open space. And what we had hoped, idealistically, was all the property owners would sit down together and hold hands, and they'd say, here's the open space, basically the northerly part, they'd give it to us for free, and here's the land to be developed, the southerly part. Now, 20 some odd years have clicked by. That didn't happen for a few reasons. One is I no longer think that people sit down together and do anything. And the other is, frankly, the city's commitment has been to State Hospital for the last 20 years. So the millions of dollars of grants we've brought in gone to State Hospital. So it's not really the property owner's fault. So we decided that approach didn't work, and now we're trying to do the same thing, but in with dollars. So we're trying to buy the northern half of the business park. And last year, with your help, we bought 80 acres. This is this next piece. The next property south, we want to buy 2/3 of it. And the last third of that property and property further south, we still think makes sense for a more intense business park. If you drive down just north of Sunnyside, you see a sign, Williams Company for sale. That was the other part of the strategy. That property we rezoned to industrial use. So it's all part of the original plan. We worked with Mass Audubon 25 years ago on what should protect and what shouldn't, but it's a more activist approach together. So he's worked with one for a really long time. The one we bought last year is important both for ecological preservation and to build a trail through, from basically a bike path through to eventually go all the way to Ryan Road School. This isn't about bike path, this is just about ecological connection. And so it's really the connection we've been trying to work for. The reason Mass Audubon's been a great partner, trying to make sure that wildlife in Mass Audubon, Arcadia Sanctuary, can make it all the way to State Hospital, all the way up to Rocky Hill. And so this is, last year was part of that link, this is the other part of the link. There's also a vernal pool, so vernal pools are places that are wet in the spring and dry most of the rest of the year, really important for amphibian breeding. The vernal pool is just off this property. The state actually is listed on this property, so I don't have to tell you that, that's not true. The vernal pool is actually just off the property, but much of the upland habitat, the place where the amphibians go when they're not in the vernal pool, is on this property. So for those two reasons, wildlife corridor
and you know, if they didn't have it as well. Just tell you quickly in terms of funding, so you know what we're asking, because it's a little complicated. So we've applied for a state grant. The state grant, if we got it, would pay for 64% of the purchase price. We're asking for the rest of the purchase price and soft costs. If we don't pick the grant, we still want to go ahead. It's a really key parcel. Obviously, it becomes a little more complicated. In that case, we are hoping that you would pay the majority of the piece against the proposal we have, and we carve away a building lot. Our first choice is not to create the building lot, and frankly, it's not going to sell for a lot. But if the choice is not, you know, if we lose an acre of land and we preserve the rest of it, it's not a bad place to do it. We've already done a due diligence, we've done a perk test, it's not a bad spot for a lot. So not ideal, but not horrible in terms of our primary building.
There's no sewer line down
there. There's no sewer. There is water, but no sewer.
You've applied for land grant already?
I've applied for land grant already.
And that you'll hear?
We should, well, we never know. They're not very predictable. October or November, although 2 years ago it looks like January, but most years October or November. Typically, quite frankly, it's October an election year, it's November a non-election year, but we don't know now. So probably before you have to make a decision, but I can't tell you that for sure.
Any questions for Wayne?
So, you know that I'm a conservationist by trade, and so I asked the critical question just because I need to get the answer. In terms of the habitat connector, it seems like, you know, when you look at the map, you've got Route 10 bisecting Arcadia and this parcel. We've got the parcel that we just conserved, which comes up to Route 10 at some point. And then across the street, there's, I think it's either an auto dump.
There's an auto, right?
It's a potential barrier to movement. And then there are a number of other pieces of infrastructure. And so what species are we talking about migrating that are gonna make it across Route 10? And just not only for me, but for everyone else, but and also, do those developments on either side of this parcel or the inholdings on the north side or the facilities on the southern side?
Let me answer the second one first because I really know the answer. And the first one, I don't know the answer. I figure how to flesh it. But so again, it is part of a picture. So we do want to get the next two-thirds of the property to the south. That's part of it. We have, I think, our second smallest conservation area is one of those thin parcels on the east side of Route 10. So we already have this very thin strip of land protected. Mass Audubon Society, with our pledge of support, but them taking the lead, has been negotiating to buy both the Carrie O'Brien piece, which is between our small conservation area and Wayside Auto on the south side, and the larger sort of grassy area to the south. So we've been working with them, and we want to connect those pieces of land together. We just bought another small piece of land as a part of the Rocky Hill piece that's on the north side that's across the street from where Mass Audubon is buying. So we're looking at sort of two different routes. We'd like to protect both of the routes through there. So it's active. Mass Audubon has just hired an appraisal for one, and they're in negotiations for one of those pieces. So we certainly get it, and we've certainly been working closely with them. In terms of species, I have to admit it would be beyond my expertise. So Mass Audubon, I wish I should have brought them here. Mass Audubon tells a wonderful story about what's there and what moves through there. And I'm not mostly nodding my head because I'm not really sure. I know that years ago when John Bodie was doing sort of assessments, he put a wildlife camera out there. He had some great pictures of a bobcat moving through there. But the problem is his effort wasn't across the board, so we don't have a frame of reference. We don't know where they're 50 times as many animals moving here as half a mile south, or could we put the camera up anywhere and have the same thing through? But we know that there are sort of big charismatic species like bobcat and moose and deer, and we suspect there's lots of smaller things. But again, Mass Audubon can tell you much better than I could. If you want, I can ask them to email you and tell us more.
Yeah, would it be possible, I think, as an opportunity to educate us all?
Yeah.
And also, I mean, so there, I think there are two questions in there. One is, what do you and Mass Audubon then envision being the end all for that connection in terms of this parcel in relationship to adjacent parcels? And then the other one is, how does that, how is it accomplished with Route 10 there? Are they planning to have some kind of crossing? Are they going to change the infrastructure of Route 10 to enable animals to get?
No, I mean, animals are, I mean, that much we know from John's cameras and from other things. Animals, and from Desink SCAT, animals are clearly crossing in large numbers. And I'm sure there's some roadkills too, frankly, but right. Animals are crossing. So no, we don't have something there. We do have like a pretty good blueprint of which parcels of land we want to acquire. It's sort of our split with Mass Audubon is they're going to acquire the east side of the road, and we're going to acquire the west side of the road. But we've been coordinating. One of the things that Mass Audubon isn't giving us cash, but when we buy conservation land now, we have to put a conservation restriction on it. That typically costs us sort of $5,000 for legal costs and then about $100 an acre. Mass Audubon is absorbing that, so it's saving us a substantial amount. So the land acquisition piece, I know the answer to. The management piece, I know the answer to, which is basically other than dealing with invasives, we have no plans to do anything. But the what's there is a question I should ask.
Okay, so let me reframe the question just a little bit. In terms of the parcel that we just acquired,
yeah.
Given your recognition that animals are crossing the roads anyways, what does this parcel get us that we don't already have? And you don't have to answer it.
Without it, I mean, if this parcel was developed to its maximum, it would block off all the access. Any other parcel would be a lot less valuable than we hoped it would be. So animals are crossing there because they don't read the signs. But if somebody developed this property. So there's a small spot along the road, which if we carved out a building lot, we'd lose about a third of the frontage, but the rest would be open. Then it goes up very, very steeply, and there's a flat plateau, fairly flat plateau, that could be developed. And that's what we're really trying to prevent. It's that 5-acre development pad in this overall parcel. That's the bad story for us, that would block wildlife movement. For both, and that's also very close to vernal pools, so both in terms of amphibians and in terms of bigger charismatic animals. So that one.
Any questions for Wayne? Thank you so much.
Thank you all very much.
Thank you.
So we have, is it 4 projects next week, Sarah?
3? Yeah, 5. No, 4.
We did 5, did we do 5? We did 5 tonight and 4 next time, correct?
Yes. And next time is?
Next time is next Wednesday.
Next Wednesday.
Really?
And a week from today?
A week from today. That's the good news.
Oh, okay,
I count. Two. And then we will meet the following week as well to begin or to extend our deliberations.
You know what? And before you took over as chair, I don't remember meeting. Yeah.
I think Down set the schedule before the last
one. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Before I took over as chair, I don't remember only getting one.
Yeah.
So we have down on our agenda to, if time allows, to review the CPA plan. Do we want to tackle that? Do we want to punt as we've been known to do with that? It is.
I'm putting it on mostly so we don't leave it by the wayside.
Okay.
There's not any particular time for to do it this evening. Okay.
I'd like to do it another time, just because I have work to do for tomorrow morning.
But anyone with a burning desire to begin that now? Is that a yes, Linda?
No, that was definitely not a yes.
Oh. So we do have on our calendars next Wednesday and the following Wednesday. So it's the 14th and the 21st, correct? Okay. And the 14th next week, Sarah, we'll have 4 presentations.
Only three.
And then we will begin deliberations. Is that how we envisioned it? Yes. And then continue our discussion.
We do not begin recommendations, which will happen after the meeting on the 21st, which is public comment.
Okay.
In the 4 remaining, one of them is the later. So haven't we taken care of?
Yeah, there's only 3. We had 5 today because Wayne had a few.
And how much do we have available, Sarah?
I will send that out between now and the next meeting, but the important figure is almost as much as has been requested. I'll send out a detailed.
I'm sorry, the state figure is almost, the state's looking good, correct?
Yeah, we're pretty sure about how much we're going to get, so we can have low and high estimates, but they're not that far apart.
Well, we don't have any affordable housing projects, so we have to carve out that 145, so that we've got less than need for the current projects.
Oh, that's a good point. Everyone here live this point?
And Vivian Housing doesn't count.
Any other further questions or comments? Is there a motion to adjourn, Mr. Evans? Second, all in favor?